All right. I figure we might as well get this started. Thank you for coming out. My name's Jack Lally. I'm the city councilor for Ward 6. With me here is the former United States Ambassador to Cape Verde, Vernon Penner. We've devoted the time today to Ambassador Penner, so he's able to talk about, you know, his experiences, other things that that he feels you might find interesting, and then answer questions afterwards.
I have been retired now for 10 years from the State Department. I worked for them for 39 years, during which time my family, myself, we served, besides working in Washington, D.C. at the State Department, I served 7 tours in Europe, Eastern and Western Europe, 2 tours in Asia, and 1 in Africa. And it was in Africa that I served, had the honor and privilege to serve as the U.S. Ambassador to the Republic of Cape Verde, in the Cape Verdean Islands. And it was kind of an exciting prospect for me in that regard, because it was not just an honor to be a presidential envoy, because all ambassadors are accredited with a letter from the President of the United States. In my case, it was President Ronald Reagan. And that's a cute story in itself, because the president, that president, Ronald Reagan, was the last president who personally met every ambassador he entitled. After Ronald got too busy, there was too much other stuff. But I'm a career diplomat, not somebody who is a political appointee who came up and said, I'll buy my way into this job, or I'll be a friend to the party, or this or that. I was a professional diplomat. And every time a diplomat serves overseas, it's kind of a question whether the White House decides whether to offer the job to a political friend, somebody obviously of the same party, or to the career diplomat who knows something about Cape Verde. Well, in actual fact, I didn't know much about Cape Verde, but I spoke Portuguese because one of my earlier tours in Europe had been as the consul at the American consulate in Oporto, Portugal. So I already spoke Portuguese, which was a help. And more than that, I was very familiar with what the embassy did in Cape Verde, which was a lot of consular operations, meaning visas and passports, citizenship issues, protection and welfare of Americans, Social Security, as I think I mentioned, is a big deal, because there had been such a diaspora of Cape Verdeans coming to the United States, so that quite frankly, there are more Cape Verdeans in America than there are in Cape Verde in terms of totals, and that's about 500,000. So when I was in Cape Verde, I was very familiar with visas and passports and things like that. But my service there was only part of my career. These 7 tours, when I joined the Foreign Service, you sort of are encouraged to select both an area, a region, to specialize in, and a function to specialize in. And basically, the State Department divides up the world into 6 regions, like Africa, Asia, Middle East, Latin and South America, Europe, Near East. And I had decided that what for me was interesting, because of my own European background, was to specialize in Europe. I had already worked in Austria in a factory while I was in college, just to get an experience of living overseas. And I felt comfortable speaking a bit German. And we have a requirement in the State Department that you have to learn a foreign language, and it's usually one of the world languages like French or Italian, German, Spanish, Portuguese. So I said I spoke German, but of course when I took the test to take and pass as a German speaker, I found I didn't really do such a hot job. So they said, well, we're gonna give you extra months of training and send you abroad to serve in a German country. So I started speaking and working on my German in Frankfurt, and that was my first post with my wife. no kids, and this was in the early 60s. And from there, we started to go around the world in other directions, but I ultimately always came back to Europe. And what I specialized in terms of work, was this consular function. This is one of these specialties. Consular meaning it's reflected in regulations, who's a citizen and who's not, who's entitled to a visa and who's not. And the protection and welfare that we extend to Americans overseas in terms of their protection, whether they're arrested, whether they're detained, whether they're sick, whether they're disappeared, that was and of course, anybody who dies overseas is an American citizen. The embassy has to send somebody and take the effects in hand if there's no next of kin there and send them home. That's another requirement we do. And every year, the amount of people who are disappeared or detained, dead or disappeared, this runs in the thousands. So, I mean, you think it's all peaceful, and of course it is peaceful, but these things happen when you're either a tourist or whether you're an expatriate living there. So I had done a lot of consular work, and the workload in Cape Verde was very consular because so many Cape Verdeans had come to the United States already dating back to the whaling days. As a matter of fact, Cape Verde has the distinction of being the only African country, sort of African, although it's an island chain off the west coast of Africa. But everybody is slightly brown, they're mulatto people, some white mix, some dark mix. They're the only people like that that came to the United States as free people. They didn't come as slaves. They many times worked their way here, and the initial way that they all worked their way here, believe it or not, was the whaling trade. And when towns like New Bedford and Fall River, Providence, you know, coastal towns had these whaling fleets, that whale oil before petroleum was discovered made these islands tremendously, made the whole idea of whaling itself something that made millionaires in places like New Bedford. That's why we have the New Bedford Whaling Museum, which incidentally happens to be the largest whaling museum in the world, with the largest collection of ivory carving scrimshaw. And it's interesting, working now at Bridgewater for the past 3 years, I knew about this whaling, and we now have a special memorandum between Bridgewater and the New Bedford Whaling Museum of cooperation, so that any student that goes to Bridgewater and doesn't have to pay the $16 entrance fee can go to the Whaling Museum for free. But more than that, the Whaling Museum is almost like the Smithsonian. It's got a warehouse full of things of people whose grandfather or great-grandfather were whalers. And now they say, what am I going to do with the harpoon? So they give it to the Whaling Museum. And they have all kinds of things. And we've just opened up a branch whaling museum in Cape Verde, showing the Cape Verdeans some of the things that they actually contributed to when they worked their way. Yankee whalers were very smart. They knew they had to pay people a lot of money to work the hours and the ships, etc. But they knew Cape Verde went through periodic periods of drought, so they would many times leave with their ships and go to Cape Verde Islands and sign on the remainder of the crew and then go whaling for 3 or 4 months. And all they would do was guarantee that if they had a successful trip, they would bring these people back to New Bedford and let them sign off and pay them a very small wage, but at least give them a little bit of money. So there's kind of an old saying about why does a woman in Cape Verde get married? And the answer is she wants to live alone, because so many of their husbands went abroad to work because in these periods of drought, there wasn't much to live on in Cape Verde. So they either went to Portugal, went to Europe, or in terms of Yankee whalers, they joined these whaling ships. And many of you perhaps have read Moby Dick. Well, Ishmael may have been a Cape Verdean, the guy that starts the story. My name is Ishmael. Because that itself is another interesting story about Cape Verde. They've had several immigrations coming to Cape Verde from Europe of nothing but Jewish people. Jewish people that were fleeing the Inquisition of Spain. And that's probably why Ishmael got the name he did. It certainly happened. While I was in Cape Verde, I actually uncovered a number of tombstones that were written in Hebrew. Now, I don't read Hebrew, I'm not Jewish, but I lived and grew up in New York City, and I certainly recognize Hebrew. So I did a little cleanup there, and we now have a Cape Verde Jewish Heritage Project going around the islands and finding these tombstones and cleaning them up and getting them readable, because for the Jewish religion, tombstones are very important. But in any case, I digress slightly. Consular is a big function. There are several other things that I've done in the State Department, and it's reflected in some of the trips I took and some of the places I went, because in addition to doing consular work, which I started doing in Germany, there's also economic work, work dealing with promoting business, writing reports on the, you know, cost of living, balance of payments, how they're paying their wages, etc. Then there's political work. The kind of thing, is this country support us in the UN? Do they vote for us or with us? Do they have the same kind of democratic government? Or are they one-party system? So you have political, economic, consular, and then you have administrative. And in the realm of administrative, like running the embassy, running the consulate, you know, paying the bills, the water, the whatever, the supplies, it also means direction. So when I served as the ambassador, I was then in the administration program direction, taking care of the embassy, responsible for all the Americans that I worked with. And the same thing when I was the consul in Oporto during the revolution. I only had three other Americans, but basically I was responsible for them and 15 Portuguese who worked at the consulate general. But in the period between Frankfurt and going to Lithuania, and that was not because I was doing political work or economic work or consular work, I was assigned for a number of years to NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, where because of my experience in Europe and traveling and speaking both German and then being trained to speak Polish, I went to Poland to speak as the linguist, being the translator there, and I was there for about 3.5 years. Speaking Polish got me involved with Eastern Europe. A position came up in NATO where I was the political advisor to the military head of NATO, a general, obviously. And that tradition for NATO to have as its military head a American military four-star general goes back to Eisenhower. He was the first, Eisenhower from World War II, was the first supreme commander in Europe. That's called him the SACEUR. And in the period that I worked at NATO, was just at a period when the wall was coming down. And we started making the first visits from NATO to these countries in Eastern Europe, which had been behind the Iron Curtain. So for example, I went with the military chief on his first visit by any military chief to Russia, to Moscow. And you know, we laid a wreath at the tomb of the unknown soldier in Moscow and said, listen, you know, the Cold War is over. We can now cooperate, hopefully. We can now work. We're not, you know, but let's face it, NATO represented the West. NATO represented the Democratic parties. For a country like Lithuania, they hadn't had any tradition of democracy. They had been first conquered by the Germans and then conquered by the Russians. But as any Lithuanian knows, there was a period of time in history when Lithuania and Poland was the greatest country in Europe, larger than any other country, France, Germany, and it stretched from the Baltic to the Black Sea. That didn't last very long, only 200 years, but the Polish-Lithuanian alliance was the biggest political entity, bigger than Russia. Russia was just a little Moscow kingdom. And so for Lithuanians, that's still part of their history. And the reason I went to Lithuania was to also explain to the Lithuanian military, which was still there, what NATO was all about and why NATO was important. I'm sorry, am I all right? Can you hear me? Yeah, okay. So normally when I travel to these countries, like when I traveled to Russia, I traveled with the four-star general, the American guy. But to make this trip to Lithuania, which had to come right at a time when the Lithuanian, the newly constituted government of Lithuania, was just getting organized, because the Lithuanians asked us from NATO to come between the period of when the Russians finally pulled out and the Pope arrived. Between that, it was a 2 or 3 week period. Between the Pope and the Russians, they wanted NATO to come. And they wanted to explain what we were going to do. So I didn't go with the American. I went with the deputy SACUR, the deputy military chief of NATO, who was an English guy. And I flew on an English plane, English bomber plane. I'm not an expert in all of this. And that's when one of the first funny stories came up. Now remember, we had been through the whole Cold War with NATO and all of the...
Good evening again, teachers and parents. Oh my God. Is there any teachers still left in their room? Could you please call down to me? Mrs. Eloquin, I know, I already know you are still here, so you don't need to. Thank you.
Anyway, so we've gone through this whole Cold War period with all the forces of NATO, and, you know, starting with Eisenhower, and, you know, all working together, trained together, knew how to handle each other, deal with each other, had a standard operation proceedings. I mean, and that, of course, is the difference why NATO is so important when we talk about what's going on now, because by training together, they all know what kind of octane gas they can run on. Everything is standardized. No other army in the world, even the Russians couldn't organize themselves like this, but NATO did. In any case, so we're going to go from Belgium, where the military headquarters were, and we were going to fly to Vilnius. So the British got, because it was a British guy that was running the show as the deputy, got one of these British bombers to come by and pick us up at a military base. So I got into this plane with this British guy, very nice uniform with him, and I had my, you know, dark suit on, looking good. And we take off for Vilnius, and we're flying. And I'm talking to this general, and he's looking at his watch, et cetera. Anyway, we arrived in Vilnius 2 hours later than we were scheduled. Nobody was there because they had waited around for an hour and they had gone home. It turns out that they hadn't realized at the RAF headquarters, the British Air Force headquarters, that Vilnius is a 2 hour difference in the time. So I thought to myself, my God, this is the military? I mean, you don't think the military, after all this time, doesn't know that Vilnius is 2 hours different than Western Europe? Anyway, that was my first wake-up call, that things were a little bit different. Vilnius was not a huge place. It had a castle. It has, what impressed me driving in from the airport, I finally found a couple of cars when I drove in, was how many telephone poles, and some of them were concrete, had bushel baskets hanging from them. But they weren't bushel baskets. They were what I had in my old neighborhood in New York City. They were basketball hoops, homemade. I could not believe that how Lithuanians got seized with basketball, but they all played basketball. And as a matter of fact, it's one of their number one sports. Is basketball. Anyway, we were received by the Lithuanians. We explained what we wanted to do. And the Lithuanians then told us, well, you know, now that the Russians have gone, our military is only about a couple of thousand guys. And this is what I think led to the creation of a Baltic force. And with NATO's help, Lithuania led a Baltic division composed of Estonians, Latvians, and Lithuanians. It was complicated because they're three different languages, and they're not necessarily so friendly together, but that's part of the whole deal of working together with NATO. If you get them on the same force together, they're not going to kill each other because they're all on the same side. The problem with Lithuania is that where that group was to be stationed. And the largest Russian military base in the Baltic countries wasn't in Lithuania, even though Lithuania was the biggest country and had the most population. The Russians had always been suspicious about Lithuania, so they put the biggest base in Latvia. And outside of Latvia and the capital of Latvia was this big base. So all of these troops would be assembled there and trained together, and that formed later what was called the Baltic Division. It really started as a regiment with just a couple of hundred guys and a couple of thousand. So now we have a situation where, frankly, they probably have a total of 10,000 people from the Baltic states all working together. So that was my big trip, the one I spent the most time cruising around Lithuania and looking over the border to where I used to, not quite, Vilnius is a little bit away from the border, but I imagined in my mind, if I could go down to the border, I mean, we could still see where I raced the ice boats down on the other side. Now, the one problem that Lithuania has is that there is a kind of a region called Kaliningrad or Königsberg, which is still, it's on the Baltic, but it's still Russian, and it is separated from Russia. And in this town, which used to be East Prussia, Königsberg, which is, of course, seized by the Russians held on to. So part of Lithuania is divided between mainland Russia and this little part on the sea with a big seaport called Kaliningrad, or Königsberg when it was German. That makes a general gray-haired like me and maybe a few others here, because it means that the Russians are there in strength. And at the time we traveled, there wasn't any problem. But lately, the Russians haven't been acting so well. The Russians have been acting very pushy. The Russians have taken steps like in places like Georgia or in the Ukraine, which is downright aggression. And so the Baltic countries feel very nervous about this. They're small, and Russia is very big. More than that, they have people in the populations of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia who speak Russian. They are ethnic Russians, perhaps, or Lithuanians who married Russians, or Russians who married Lithuanians. So these people themselves could be conceived of as Russians. Just as in Georgia on the south coast, back down there in the Black Sea, there is these parts of Georgia that Russia has seized by claiming that it's really full of Russian-speaking people and it's part of Greater Russia. And we have part of Moldova with the same way, still in the Russian hands. And now for 2 years, Crimea is in Russian hands. It certainly is not in separatist Ukrainian hands, it's in Russian hands. These are some of the problems that we face today strategically and certainly militarily. But that period of time when I worked in NATO is a time when I got to almost all of the countries in Eastern Europe, including my own country of where I had been for 3 years with Poland. But I was serving with a general, the general who succeeded Eisenhower by 14 or 15 different generals, who was of Georgian origin. His name was Shalikashvili. And here was a Georgian American, a kid who only came to the United States when he was 7 years old and had fled to Poland during the war as a little kid and then got caught up in the war and then fled to Germany. And from Germany, he came to America as a DP, if you remember, displaced person. Now he was the head of NATO. And we used to joke about that because the one language we had in common was Polish, because I had already studied Polish, and he spoke Polish, which would very much confuse anybody that we met who would say, what are these guys speaking? Except in Poland, nobody really knew. So it was kind of our private language. And Shalikashvili, it is unusual, but it's sort of the story of immigrants coming to the United States. And we used to joke about his English or my bad Polish, because he spoke Polish much better than I did, even though I had been trained as a translator. But in between working in Frankfurt and even Poland, I also served in Austria, Switzerland, Japan, Vietnam, and then again back in Washington before going to NATO, and then coming out of NATO and working in Washington again, where I was director of the visa office, during which time we issued about 5 million tourist visas and about 500,000 on an annual basis immigrant visas. And I was responsible for all the visas issued overseas. It's a lot of visas, a lot of people being interviewed. And I feel very strongly that some of the current administration are not considering the realities of how we issue visas. Because I can assure you that nobody has a more careful screening process for visas than the Americans. And the State Department issues those visas overseas. But we can talk about that depending on questions. But anyway, what I've tried to do in the, 20 minutes, was to talk a little bit about my career, places like Lithuania. I can tell you funny stories dealing with Shalikashvili's. The first time we went with Shalikashvili to Poland was kind of fun because he spoke Polish and there wasn't a real need for anybody to understand. And he was talking to the Poles about how we deal with groups of minorities in our own countries. I mean, the Poles had to deal with still some people from Germany that were in their country, etc. And Shalikashvili was sitting there in front of a bunch of generals saying, well, you know, America shouldn't really talk about how it treats minorities because imagine how we treated the Seahawks. Seahawks. So I thought to myself, Seahawks. Then I realized here's a 7-year-old who taught himself English by going to the movies, to the Western movies. So I wrote on a little piece of paper and I slipped it to him while he was talking and I say, you pronounce it S-U-E, Sue. Because what he was saying was, Americans don't have any right to talk about treating minorities when we don't say, how do we treat the Indians? And so in his mind, he saw S-O-U-X, and he pronounced it Seahawks. And I always remember, so he kind of laughed at me, kept talking. I mean, this is America. It's America like I came here from my French side, where I'm 15 generations ago. And it's America where people are coming one generation ago. And why it's important for me to be up at a place like Bridgewater State University, where if you ask the president of Bridgewater State University, what's the importance of education? He'll probably tell you social justice, justice and fairness to people, on understanding them, on reaching out and being open, not closed. So I feel strongly about that. I feel strongly about working. Thankful to Jack for bringing me out here. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to talk to you.
I got a question.
Go for it.
So you were one of the first people into Lithuania.
Representing not the U.S. government.
Right, after
the representing fall. NATO.
After the fall of the Soviet Union?
Exactly.
So what was that?
Nobody could go into that. It was in, I can almost tell you the exact date. It was in 92. The Russians took a while to withdraw.
Right.
You know, and some of it was dragged out, for example, from East Germany.
And it was violence.
Pardon me?
It was violence.
No, it was violent in the sense that they ripped off a lot of the community, took everything out from the kitchen sink to the bathtubs. But there wasn't any shooting. They withdrew in a variety of ways. For example, from East Germany, I can't say exactly how they withdrew from Lithuania, either by air or by train, probably. But the way they withdrew from Germany, I know very well because I celebrated with some German sailors. I still sail. But I sailed out of, in German military naval academy boats with a German captain, and he took me up to an island off of East Germany by Stralsund, an area that had been in East Germany. And the island was the last place that the Russians left from. And they were driving their trucks up there and putting them on what I looked like to me was Ferry Island, Staten Island ferry boats. and they would just drive their trucks on the boats and then slowly move along the coast to Russia. And so we all celebrated the last withdrawal. I can't tell you how the Russians left Lithuania, but they all left. Now there's only a border, but it's not well marked. It's not there with, you know, barbed wire, etc. It's a fairly open border. But now the difference is Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia belong to NATO. And as a NATO member, they have the protection so that any attack on them is considered an attack on all of us. That's a Robin Hood clause. An attack on one is and we are duty bound, we as in America, are duty bound to go to their defense in some form or another. It doesn't necessarily mean we send 100 divisions, but it's send we recognize, just as when 9/11 happened, NATO countries actually agreed that we were being attacked and sent airplanes over here to patrol in case other airplanes were making attacks like they did on the towers, the twin towers, and in Washington. Anyway, that's the story. Does that answer your a little bit about this period of time in Lithuania and how the Russians and?
I think so. I thought I read that you were one of the first people into.
Yeah, exactly. But we hadn't opened an American. There wasn't an American embassy.
Was it?
I mean, there was maybe a representative living in a hotel.
Was there an effect in Lithuania from being under their rule for so long?
Pardon me?
Did it have an effect on the community? Was it?
Obviously, this was a period of transition for them to form their own government. Interestingly enough, all of them formed democratic governments, and they right from the get-go, with several parties. But it was an uneasy period because nobody knew really what was going on. I think certainly the three Baltic countries can be proud of the fact that nobody turned their back on democracy, even with Russia breathing down their shoulder. But I didn't I didn't come as a representative of the U.S. government. I came as a civilian to demonstrate the importance of civilian, as the political advisor to a British army general in an Air Force plane that didn't know that there was 2 hours difference between Vilnius and where we were, which I thought was pretty embarrassing. So anyway, that's kind of what was going on. But I might ask you this. You realize that there were two countries that never recognized that Lithuania, Estonia, and Latvia were under Russian domination or even German domination. But right from the time when the Germans invaded Lithuania, there was a free government set up in London. So all during the German occupation, all during the Russian occupation, the Americans were one of two countries that continued to recognize free Lithuania. Not that they could do anything, not that they could even go there, because it was under the Nazis or under the communists. Does anybody have any idea what the other country was? It's kind of a trick question. It was the Vatican. Vatican recognized it, and partially because of the number of Catholics in those countries, but they refused to recognize anybody appointed by either the Germans or the Russians to run the church. It had to be appointed by the Pope. It's a smart move by the Vatican. For the Americans, I think the fact that we had longstanding Lithuanian, Estonian, and Latvian populations here, we were not going to turn our back and say, you're now a part of Russia. So you can be kind of proud of that fact. Any other thoughts and questions? Yes, please. Pardon me? I'm a diplomat in residence. They provide me with a small honorarium to fly up here, fly to Providence, rent a car, and live on campus for a week. Then I go home. My wife says, where have you been for the past couple of days? I got to go and mow the lawn, get everything else fixed. But I'm a diplomat in residence. I've been doing it for 3 years. And basically, my job as the diplomat in residence is to meet students, meet guys like Jack, who's more than just a student, I might add. But and we're very proud of that fact. But to mentor students, to talk to students about opportunities that maybe they hadn't thought about because they speak another language. Maybe they should think about the State Department. Why should we be training me to spend 11 months learning Polish when they could probably find a Polish-American kid who already spoke it at home? And so one of the things we try to do is look for these opportunities for Fulbright awards, scholarships, internships, and try to get kids thinking more than just Brockton and Bridgewater, but maybe even Washington, D.C. So I do that. I also deal with international programs and the programs that are now being set up, for example, in Cape Verde, because I know the country and I know the people. I guess other things that you find me doing there in terms of mentoring, I also lecture. That's not so easy because everybody nowadays has a structured curriculum. It's, you know, and I don't come, you know, smoking a pipe and looking like some academic guy with some PhD. I have a master's degree, but I thought that was pretty hot stuff because I had to work on that, but I don't have a PhD. Academia plays great stock in that, and they're very proud of the fact that a lot of all their teachers are very well educated. I like to think that if they're going to talk about Vietnam, I'll be happy to talk about Vietnam when I heard, you know, when there was a bup, 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 and I was sitting in some trench, you know, holding my head together. I can sometimes add reality to some of the courses. Like, what is it really like to live in a communist country? It's difficult to describe communism and a one-party state to kids that never had that issue. And matter of fact, all they do is see a bunch of parties fighting together here. But at least they know they got a choice every few years, and it's a free choice. Hopefully it is a free choice, if it isn't being influenced unduly by the FBI or by somebody else, but at least it's a free choice. Anyway, that's what I do at Bridgewater.
Thank you.
You had a question? You all set? I might just end by saying what we're trying to do with Cape Verde. Because of my relationship with Cape Verde and the Cape Verdean government, when I worked in Cape Verde, I had to leave my kids behind. I had a 17-year-old daughter and a 10-year-old son. And there were no schools in English, French, and German, of course. There were only primary schools and two high schools in the entire country. Two high schools, and every island had some grammar schools. So if you were a smart kid in grammar school, you had to usually go to one of the two main islands to go to high school. So Bridgewater was absolutely indispensable in getting them to set up their first university, the University of Cape Verde. And it's important to know that Bridgewater had an advantage here because, you know, it's a very old university, 1840. And it was set up by three very prominent people, John Quincy Adams, Horace Mann, and who's the third guy that we, John Quincy Adams, Horace Mann, and Daniel Webster. I mean, these guys, Daniel Webster, I mean, Webster's Dictionary. These guys really know their stuff. They set the school up just at a time when a lot of normal schools here were running, you know, schools of learning, and they set it up as a school to teach teachers. And that's exactly what Cape Verde helped and needed at their University of Cape Verde. They needed professional training. So by every year training a half a dozen or a dozen Cape Verdeans to go back, we've actually formed a core of education people there, and we feel very proud about that. In the process, the New Bedford Whaling Museum was set up. We've got the relationship with them. We may, in fact, write a definitive book on whaling from Cape Verde's standpoint. I had a picture in my office in Cape Verde showing one of the small ports, and from one end of the port to the other end of the port were 17 American whale ships all tied together. So you didn't have to, you could cross from one side of the port to the other by just walking across the ships. We whaled them out. We whaled them out. In the 4 years of living there and visiting all the islands by sailboat, I only saw a whale once, because they may be not even migratory, they live there. But they're coming back, you see. Anyway, any other thoughts, Jack?
No, I'd
want to say thank you again to you for organizing this and giving the opportunity. I hope you'll think about a little differently about the State Department, that they're career people, not just political appointees.
And
Lithuania.
Are you planning to write a book? You seem to have had a lot of experience and a lot of travel.
I think it would be a very interesting book.
Well, that's
I think you could write a pretty interesting book.
You know, but I'm not a secret guy. You know, a lot of stuff. I think if I tried to explain some of these things, like being late 2 hours in Lithuania, that's a downright embarrassment. But I mean, there are a lot of funny stories like sea hooks and other things that I have encountered in my time, or even Ronald Reagan. I'll leave you with one final story of Ronald Reagan, because, as I said, he met every ambassador, and he didn't hand them his instructions, but he said he wanted to meet because they were the personal representatives of the president. So I had these two kids, the 17-year-old girl and I had the 10-year-old boy. And I asked them, you know, first of all, I said, you know, he's gonna call me because he would call your house. So one day I came home at noon and my son had come home from school. My daughter was coming home. He said, what are you home from school for? And I said, well, President Reagan is gonna call me. He said, you know, come on, Dad, you know, it's a bunch of crap. Yeah. I said, no, he's gonna call me. Well, in fact, he called me. So I got on the phone and he said, you know, I want to appoint you ambassador to Cape Verde. Fortunately, he was, I'm sure, reading it, because he could have, you know, he could have said to Lithuania for all he knew. But anyway, he said Cape Verde. And so then I got in the mail an official invitation to meet him at the White House. Now, by this time, my son is realizing that this is really serious. And I said to the kids, listen, what do you think about going to see Ronald Reagan? My daughter, who was an aspiring actress, as all 17-year-old girls seem to be, said, well, you know, I think it's wonderful that a former actor could play such an important role in American political life and speak so articulately and have such, you know, a charming atmosphere, da, 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 da. So I said to my son, and what do you think about Ronald Reagan? And he said, yeah, he's an old fart. I said, no, don't use that language. He's an old guy. My son didn't like him. So we go in to meet President Reagan in the White House, in the Oval Office. We only have 15 or 20 minutes. And of course, beforehand, I wrote a little biography about my wife and about my kids. So he knew their names, and of course, he's on a little card. And so he's talking really about my wife, because, you know, she's a tennis player, and she rides horseback, and there's a lot of stuff. And, you know, she asked my daughter, where are you going to college, and da-da. And then he looks at my son, and my son had his tie, just like this, not like that. So suddenly, he runs around to his desk, opens a drawer, comes back, and he goes like this. He puts in my son's tie a White House tie clasp. So we said goodbye to Ronald Reagan, da-da-da-da, and we're leaving the White House, walking up the street, executive, you know, things were, in those days, were not so covered with police, etc. And I say to the kids, my daughter, I said, well, what do you think about President Reagan now? He said, he didn't ask you anything about Cape Verde. He didn't ask you one serious question about what your role is going to be representing him. I think he really doesn't know much about anything. I said, whoa. I said, didn't you like him before? I certainly don't like him now, she said. I said to my son, and what do you think about Reagan? And my son says, I'm never going to wash my hand again. Because he had shaken hands. And even today, at the age of 40 years old, he has in his office him shaking hands with Ronald Reagan. So I leave you with that story, okay? Jack,
I want to thank you for coming out, and I also want to thank Ward 6's school committee woman, Joyce Azak, for being here.
Hey,
yep.
I hope we didn't bore you.
Yep, but if there's any other questions, any other comments, or... All right, well, thank you all for coming out, and thank you, Ambassador Penner, for coming.
Jack. Thanks for this. This is America in action.
All right, have a good evening.
Thank you.